Greetings, fellow Earthlings, and welcome to this tiny garage. Any of you watching last week will have witnessed the separating of the halves, which was quite satisfying, I'd have to say. I didn't realise that these engines were put together like a Russian doll. And look, there are the pistons. Many of you had questions about the condition of the pistons and the cylinders. We're going to talk about that today. Okay, step one here is to remove the crankshaft seal, which I'd have to say at this stage seems like cheating because it's not really held in. You just sort of grab it. There it is. On the same note, the rear main seal requires no more special tools than fingers. Now here, the bearing carrier, I'm reliably informed, is ready to come out. Thank you, Lee Jenkins at Hartech, for confirming with me that this was possible. Two people would be handy for this, or something just to hold the bottom half in place. Now, I cringe a little bit here. I'm going to invest in a rubber crowbar, everybody. Now, there was hope. It obviously was loose. And obviously, it is heavy. And so all of these factors combine. We know that that weighs at least 85 pounds there. Now, that is just a complete mess, I agree. I was freaking out a little, but it ended up being okay. All right, the intermediate shaft, the IMS. It just seems so, you know, right there now. It's not so mysterious. Trying to angle the engine in a way that makes some sort of sense. So now, like the Poseidon Adventure again, it is upside down. There is the IMS shaft. Now that is the timing chain for bank two. It goes off of the pulley end of the IMS. And I couldn't get the other end off, it's too tight. And so here we have three 10 millimeters that are holding on to the chain guide on one side and then the guide and tensioner on the other side, just like the other timing chains. It's a very similar story. This tensioner had a circlip on it. Hold on everybody, something new. Now, if you look at that circlip tool, which I'm rubbish at, I had that in the toolbox. It's a little rusty. It's got an odd screw through the middle, but it still worked. And with that circlip off, that tensioner guide came off. I thought it had braille on the front, but it turns out that's just tremendous wear. And it is a little crazy to think that you have to take this engine apart to this degree if you plan on replacing that. And it does make me feel good about having taken it apart this much, because believe you and me, your suggestions of just putting new Vario cam pads in and moving on was very tempting. Now, it is a lot looser here, and that was the magic. You just lift up the back and it just all comes out. That meaty chain that came off there is the IMS chain. And then the other one that's right next to it is for bank one. Now we're sending this away to get pinned. So do you see how there's like three different sprockets plus the IMS bearing, which is smooth as glass, by the way. Apparently those sprockets can move independent of each other because they're just press fit. And that's what the whole pinning thing's about. We're going to talk about that more in the future, next week. This item here, I am reliably told, is called a top bracket plastic. There are six H5 bolts in that guy. It seems like the kind of plastic that might be easy to snap. So far, it is still alive. All right, the weigh-in. Why am I bothering? I would like to know, when I'm putting this back together, what are we dealing with? I couldn't find accurate numbers anywhere for what a full engine and transmission really weighs. So as I've alluded to before, that bearing carrier in more or less complete condition is 85 pounds. And then each of the banks, each half of the cylinder case, is around 43 pounds. Not saying it's the most accurate measuring ever, but just to get a gist, you know? Product familiarization, everybody. Here we go. Look at the front of this thing. That, the open-ended side, that's showing you that this is bank one and that's cylinder one. We're at the pulley side here. So therefore, that guy there, that is cylinder four on bank two. Another thing I'm looking at here is, remember when we were taking out those bolts? They were holding the bearing carrier in place. And then on bank one, we had two bolts, and the second one just goes in the bottom there. They're both T50s. The top one has the seal. That's the same in both banks. Now, if we look here on bank two, in the top, there is that same T50 with the rubber seal on it. But at the bottom, that is a blank. You can't do anything there. Now that's another way of getting an orientation of what's going on with the bearing carrier. There's the rear main seal or the flywheel end. That's the pulley end, the part you see when you open the engine hatch. Now this is all bank one. We've got two bolts there. You see that gap? The gap is on the rear main seal end. That means that we've got cylinders 1, 2, and 3 right here. Now the single bolt, you see how we have that extra space on the pulley end of that bank. So that's how we know that that's bank 2 and that's cylinders 4, 5, and 6. That's the reason for that. It's so that we know what everything is. And then I am marking it up. It's going to get wiped off, I'm sure, here and there. But really, I just wanted to... I was afraid I would put it in upside down, which I realize now you're not going to do that. But I wanted to feel confident that I knew what the bits were and how everything kind of went back in. Bank one, which is where numbers start, has the starter motor mount on it, which is a pretty obvious proboscis sticking out of the top. And so that will help you know which bank is which. Now looking here, people want to know what condition the cylinders and the pistons are in, and I really wanted to know too. So let's start with a cylinder bore. Quite a difficult thing to photograph. I shoot all of this on an iPhone, and it had trouble focusing with just an open cylinder like that. But you can see the ultimate message I'm trying to make here is they are nice. So here I put some aluminum tape on the backside, and that kind of helped. Moving a flashlight around in a circular pattern. Here's bank two. Not showing you all the cylinders because they're all more or less the same. They're all pretty nice. No bore scoring, really. They are like glass. The only thing really to note, if any of you were watching previously when we first got the cylinder head off, I did notice a mystery line. Here's some footage from that episode. Right there in the top left, kind of at 11 o'clock within the cylinder bore. I know now, thank you Ken Cross, that that is actually the top of the compression ring and is normal, and we're not going to worry about that. Moving on to the other side of that equation, the piston skirts. Here we are, that's piston one top and bottom. That's what the T and B mean. That yellow square that you can see on the side of the pistons is the special ferrostan coating that's applied to the piston skirts at the factory. Really, it's hardly worn. It has very slight patches of wear on some cylinders, like right there you can see it. But that is great, and we're going to have that redone, and it's only $26 per piston. That's really quite good news. Okay, don't do this. This is my message. I thought in order to get the pistons out, I had to open up the case. And you do ultimately, but don't do it yet. Do this first. Okay, we're going to remove the connecting rod caps. This was way more fun than I thought and very easy. We just undo that bolt. It is a 12.10 millimeter socket. Not that exotic. It turned out I had a set of them on the wall already. Now that is the bearing. Those bearings are called bearing shells. They're in two halves. One half is on the conrod cap and one half is on the sort of piston side of the conrod. There's another bearing cap. I would say that all of the bearing shells on the piston side of the conrod had more wear in that sort of one spot, but not anything crazy. I am going to get these looked at by some experts. Feel free to tell me what you think in the comments about the condition of these bearings. I am trying to just sort of get at the bolts that are easy to reach, but really the eureka moment I had, I'm rotating it here to try to be a good boy and just not disturb too much. But yeah, if you just rotate the crank, you can get to anything, anywhere. There's that piston side of the bearing shell that has more wear really than the other side. And when you take them apart, you see how that just falls out there. It's very easy. Not too much torque on those bolts. I am trying to organize everything as best I can, keeping everything in Ziploc bags. All right, the bearing carrier bolts. I did this in the wrong order. I'm recommending that you do this next. It is okay if you do it the other way around. It did work out, but this does make more sense. Again, that 12.10mm socket wrench will fit these guys perfectly. I thought there was something more exotic, but that's all there is to it. Thank you again, Lee Jenkins at Hartech UK. Have you not called them yet? Same thing here on the other side. Of course, WD-40, just to annoy some of you. Quite a lot of torque on these. The bulk of the bearing carrier helps in this case. You can get a pretty good grip on it without it moving around too much. I am thinking about using a very strong glue and gluing that rubber mat on top of this hydraulic table. It keeps just coming off, nothing holds it. It seems like maybe they attempted to glue it. You can see residue of glue there. Anyway, when you're moving these heavy items on top and they're covered in oil, it feels like it might be easy for it to slip off. All right, moment of truth, here we go. I'm rotating onto its side here. Bank 2 is on the bottom. And just wiggling, pulling. Yay, there it is. A crankshaft, everybody. I just can't help like spinning it, it feels good. And those are the bearing shells. I think that's what I bought from Hartech UK, is those big end bearings. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for this week. Thank you very much for watching. Till next time.